Welcome to Cute Widgets and More. In today's episode, I will show you how you can automate a bunch of things from within Cute Creator. In other words, how to use, among other things, keyboard macros. So in today's episode, I will show you a bunch of videos that I recorded. Let me just admit that I tried doing it in a live session. It just didn't turn out because I would do something wrong each and every single time, and then I would re-record and re-record, and it took forever. So I decided I'll just record what I want to show you as videos, and then I will comment on what I'm doing in these recordings. The whole idea is that using keyboard macros, you can actually automate a bunch of things, but you need to be working in a bit of structured way. Keyboard macros, unfortunately, isn't as super cool as it is in, for example, Emacs, which has the best and most awesome keyboard macros, but it's still good enough for the smaller kind of edits. So let me get one of the videos started. What I'm about to be doing here, what you look at here is one of the many places where I show this Depeche model. And in this version here, you can see that it says true, 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 false, whatever. That is whether it has been released on LP and CD and cassette tapes and whatnot. And I had an episode where I showed you to use enums instead, and rewriting all of these true and false and whatnot to enums was rather a lot of work, but fortunately I did it with macros. So that was when I thought, hey, let me create an episode on macro so you can see how to do that. So let's get started here. The first thing I want to do is to get them all on one line. And you can see they're all split on two lines. So having them on one line makes it easier to record those macros. I just did a few here just trying out. And if you look down at the bottom of the screen now, you can see that in just a second, it will say macro mode. That's because I press Control Open Brace, which now I'm recording. So I go to the end of the line, I cut that, and you can see how fast it is now to get them all on the same line in there. That was step number one. Next step, I want all of these true and false columns to align, because then I can use column commands for it. Unfortunately, this is not Emacs with its super powerful Lisp. It's somewhat more limited powerful. So I couldn't go in all the way, but I could still use a bit of macro. So you can see I search for comma here to find the location where the true starts. So this location here, that's a macro that gets me to that, and it stops. And then I can, by just typing myself, get the next input there. You can see I align up, I execute the macro that gets me to the location. I align up and I press in a bunch of spaces and so on. And as you've seen in just a few seconds, when we get to, let me see, Sounds of the Universe below, I was searching for comma and already they're playing the angel. I was searching for comma and I got to the wrong location, but that's okay. This is a keyboard macro that's supposed to be running interactive. It's not a Perl script that needs to be 100% correct, but more something where I just need to get it correct most of the time and so on. So now I have lined everything up. That was step number two. There is, of course, many strategies that can be applied when you want to do something like this. I thought I will line all of the columns up, and then I will simply apply a bit of rectangular commands on these, as we'll see in just a second. But as you can see, this true column here has been lined up perfectly. But as soon as we go down to the third column here, you can see they aren't aligned up here. And the reason for that is simply that false is longer than true. So that's what I'm fixing in the next step here. And I'll simply select the whole section here, because now search and replace is only within this section here. And I will search for true comma, and that will be to true comma space. And I just tried it a few times there, and now I'm running it for just going for the replace all. And now you can see that it actually did line up perfectly well, ready for step number, what are we at? Four, I guess. So next step, I want to remove the commas there. So I thought, hey, let me just do a rectangular area here and just search and replace for comma. So I did search for comma and replace that with nothing. And as you can see there, it goes well until I actually pull that other comma into my rectangular command, rectangular area. So that's no good, and that's what you'll often find when you do these things with macro. So instead, I decide to simply use a rectangular area control and just your usual control and arrow keys to select a rectangle. But if you want it to, if you do that without anything else, then you'll have it over the lines. But the rectangles that you see here that I pulled down, that's control shift and arrow keys. And that's a very nifty little feature in Qt Creator. And I'm removing the rest of them. Let's just speed up there. And there we are. The next part here is a bit painful to watch simply because it feels that it takes forever. But trust me, if you were to do this by hand, it would take a lot longer. So what I'm trying to do here is now to search and replace true to be whatever that column is about. And this is about download. And as you can see from the drop-down box, even when I recorded this session, I've already tried it like a number of times and something went wrong. So pipe download, that's because I want to do the bitwise OR for each of them at the end. And you can see I got it download there. And now going for the next column, and I use the rectangular commands again to pull out that column. I guess I pulled one too many there, but let's not worry too much about that because it's just the rectangle in which I am actually doing my. So true should now be, I can't remember what that is, some kind of tape, I think it was. And it was the MD. And what happened there? I don't know. I've been watching this a number of times. When I did the recording, I thought, well, maybe I forgot to drag out the rectangular commands, but I certainly did. I can see that in the playback here now. So something went wrong. See, this is what it looks like when you don't have the rectangular commands and it covers the full line here. It now does have the regular commands, and true is now being replaced, this time without any problem with MD. Should have said space or the vertical bar space MD, but yeah, that's the kind of things that you get wrong sometimes when you do these macro recordings, and then you just need to fix those up. Here true, not truer, true should be replaced with cassette tapes, I guess. No, DCC, there we are. And this one is LP, I'm sure. And you can see they are all, so there's no need to search and replace. I can just type it directly in here. And here is the cassette tapes. There are a bunch of those. There we are, cassette tapes. And finally, the CD, which all of them is, again, rectangular command, typing in. Just as soon as I created my rectangle command, I type it in. And as you can see, I realize there's no reason to have the OR front because I just need to remove that later on. And we're almost there now, ready for step number 6. So in the final part, I need to get rid of all those faults in there. And I could have done that in multiple different ways, but I search for faults space. That of course does not hit all of them. I can't see why it wouldn't hit the second part. Well, it actually did on the first line there. So, but of course it didn't hit those with false comma. And yes, but please don't do false comma and replace that to nothing, because then you're going to be doomed. But I think that I'll be safe because I search and replace it to comma, which is okay. And here's replace all. And now, come on, press it. You can do that. Just sitting there thinking for a second, and it looks good. I'm almost done now. I need a bit of touch up for it to be looking better. But the key thing here is I'm removing the double spaces there. The key thing here is that, would it have been faster to do this not without macros? Maybe. Would it be as much fun? Well, I don't know if this was any fun at all, but at least it's it's less error prone. I urge you to go back and watch the episode where I introduced these, and you'll actually notice that I actually managed to introduce a bug, but I didn't bother fixing that when I was looking at that in that episode. But anyway, now we have it with the CD or CS or LP representing something that was in, that was released on these medias there, and I think it looks better. And could we have used macros to fix up the alignment on the third on the rest of the columns here? I don't think so. I would likely have done something with search and replace possibly, but I'm not even sure if I could pull that off. Maybe this would be a time where I would just get a shell script or a Perl interpreter or a Python interpreter or something else out, seat, awk, you name it, and do it using those commands. But over the years, I've appreciated macros for these things where I just needed to do a repetitive thing over and over again, and I hope that I inspired you here. I have one more example that I'd like to show you with macros. This comes from my spare time programming where I'm developing an application on Android with Qt. Go and have a look. KPhotoAlbum, a KDE application that has a Qt backend. Do not hold me against any standards, because that's never mind. Anyway, in there I had a problem where my application crashed on the Android side, and I couldn't exactly figure out where, and for some reason I couldn't get a debugger attached to the binary. So what I simply did was, in every single function where I thought it could be an issue, I printed out, hey, I'm in this function now, and I did so using a bit of macros and so on. So all I needed to do was to add a function called trace, or it wasn't a function, it was a macro that expanded to some function call. But anyway, just add the letters trace to the beginning of all of my functions. And that was super annoying doing by hand, so I recorded a bit of macro that did that for me. Let me show you what it looks like. Actually, it wasn't all that simple, because what I needed to do was to find the starting point of all the functions. And how would I easily do that? I tried something with collapsing all of my functions, because if I collapse them all, then they would be, I would be pretty easy, except this one here that was over two functions. But you can see the other function, I was just walking one function step each time. So I went to our internal chat room and I asked, can you guys give me an idea of a good way to do this? And one of my coworkers asked me, so how would you have done that in Emacs? And I was like, well, I would search for a regular expression that had a start of the line, then the open brace and end of line, because I knew all my starting functions, they had this open brace, because I'm using Clang format. There's another episode of that where I can, that guarantees me that. And he said, why don't you do that inside of Qt Creator? I said, well, I can't search as regular expression. He said, sure you can. I said, how? And he said, well, just go down to your search and press the arrow down there. I never seen that arrow. It's like 10 pixels on my screen. I'm sorry, but let's see what it does here. It actually allows me to search for regular expressions. And now my macro was super easy. So start macro recording, search for the regular expression of an opening brace like this. That's what I want. And now I found it. I press escape a number of times and I insert my trace, whatever it was called. That's the end of that macro. I have a key binding for run most recent macro, Alt+r. You can see it inserts it in all the places, just nice and smooth. And actually it inserts it multiple times if I overwrap, but that's another thing. Most of my macros are very short-lived. I will record them, I'll run them a bunch of times, and I'll be done with it. But if I want my macro to survive a bit longer, which this particular one I might have had wanted to, I can just name it, and then I have it in my list of commands that I can run from Qt Creator. Let me show you how you do that. Simply go to Tools, Text Editing Macros, Save Last Macro, give it a name. We could call it Trace. Insert Trace like this and save it. Now to run that macro, I need to go Control K, RM for Run Macro, and here's my list of all the macros I've saved, namely just this one. But anyway, here it is, and it's inserted. Control K, Enter, Control, whoops. Control K, Enter, Control, Control K, I must have messed up. RM Trace, there we are. Control K, Enter, yes, I can do that. So that's how to save them. It's a bit more awkward to rerun them once you've saved them, unless you go and actually make a keybinding for them. So Tools, Options, where are my keybindings? I just got that idea just as I was speaking. It's in my environment, of course. Keyboard, search for Trace. There it is. And I can give it a keybinding. I don't know what I could possibly not have bound on my keyboard anymore. But if I had, I guess Windows F12, that didn't work out on KISS. There we are, Windows F12. That seems scary. Let me try something else. Control Shift F12 and stop recording. Okay. And let's see, Control Shift F12. Yeah, that worked out well. I guess that is bound for something else from within my window manager. Otherwise it would have worked. Can I please get some points for at least trying? Macros and rectangular commands are definitely always part of my toolbox for text editing en masse. It's very useful. And if you haven't already bound, I'm not entirely sure whether it's bound by default, but if you haven't, if it doesn't work by pressing Alt+r to run most recent macro rush and make that keybinding, because that makes all of the difference. I'm Jesper Petersen. I hope you enjoyed this episode. Let me have your thoughts in the comments below. And as always, do give me your thumbs up and all of those other things. Until next time, have a great time.
Would you like to start learning Qt widgets properly? Then have a look at our highly rated training courses on kdab.com.